Hi, I'm Stu Jeffries, and tonight we've got Beaver Fever, eh? You asked for it, so here it is. Just for you, a look at two decades of Canadian rock and roll, past, present, and future, all on show number 174 of Canada's first video magazine series. Good rockin' tonight. I was wrong. That's The Crew Cuts with Canada's first million-selling single ever. It goes way back to 1957, called Shaboo. Also that same year, The Diamonds sang Little Darlin' to the top of the charts. And the year before that, the four lads were standing on the corner watching their song become an international smash hit. Question of the day, how important is it to have American recognition, and is it necessary to move south to get it? Let me tell you, back then it was essential. Canada's first teen idol, Paul Anka from Ottawa, is a prime example of that. His single Diana went number one worldwide, and then Paul moved to Los Angeles to be closer to the heart of the business. Times have changed now, thankfully, and Canadian artists now have recognition anywhere records are played. Tonight we'll look at our current and our future Canadian stars, but we'll also remember the past. After all, some things never change.
People say love's a game. A game you just can't win. If there's a way, I'll find it someday. And then this fool will rush in. To hear,
ah, memories. That was then, this is now. Today's ABC of Canadian rock, Adams, the Blondes, and Corey talk about living in Canada.
I'm not really sure why Canada is more accepted, you know, has accepted me more than maybe any other place in the world, except for the fact that I'm a Canadian boy and I let everybody know it. Everyone always asks me, you know, when are you moving to LA or something, you know, and I have no intention of moving away from Vancouver because it's, as far as I'm concerned, it's one of the most beautiful cities I've ever seen in my life, and I just like it here, you know. My friends are here, my family's here, so I'm not going to move.
We started the band in Toronto, and, you know, it's, Canada's just as important to us as America or Europe or anywhere. Well, you've got new bands coming out with some great, great sounds. They don't sound English, they don't sound American, they sound Canadian. You've got a lot of Canadian singers out there that sound American, just for American music, American purposes. But right now, it seems to be, the trend is going towards sounding original and from that, you know.
Yeah. I think just the people out there too, I mean, there's so many people that are into the music from Canada.
Yeah.
Which is really exciting because I've been here for a few years. When I first came here, there wasn't that excitement at all.
No.
Well, it was foreign bands.
But now it's like, it's the kids are going, yeah, rock and roll, you know, and it's like Canadian rock and roll, which is terrific.
After traveling in America so much, I really believe there is a Canadian identity, and it's almost something that I couldn't describe verbally to you what the differences were, but I feel them.
Yeah.
I feel when I'm back in Canada, there's a certain quality within the Canadian people, and a certain quality about the way of life and the attitudes that exist that's different from America. And I feel very Canadian. It's very ambiguous because it's hard to describe, but I think about sometimes that, you know, this is where I was born, and this is where I started to cultivate my ideas and cultivate my views on things, and that's very important for me to know that it was Canada. American woman, mama, let me be.
No more. I got more important things to do. To spend my time growing old with you. Said woman, baby said get away. American woman, listen what I say.
The Guess Who saying it's no longer necessary for a band to move to the States to be successful. American woman, stay away from me. Number one hit for them in 1970.
Things to do. To spend my time growing. Baby said, get away, American woman, listen what I say,
The Guess Who saying it's no longer necessary for a band to move to the States to be successful. American woman, stay away from me. Number one hit for them in 1970. The most recent newcomers to the American charts, Glass Tiger, One to One, and these guys, Honeymoon Suite.
On Good Rock, and tonight I don't got really much to say. I'm having a great day here. I haven't been in the U.S. probably since January, February, March, and we're back here in Vancouver to do our own show for a change in Canada, where we belong. And all I can say is it's great to be home!
Hi, I'm Stu Jeffries. This is Beaver Fever. Backman-Turner Overdrive took good care of Canadian business in 74, becoming household names everywhere. BTO followed that with You Ain't Seen Nothing Yet. That was number one in 1974, and it started manager Bruce Allen on a steady succession of hot acts. Prism, Red Rider, Loverboy, Bryan Adams, and these guys from Vancouver, Idolize.
How about future plans now, kind of tours, anything in the works?
I think we'll be starting off, with a Canadian tour, but depending on the reaction in Europe and in the States, we may go to Europe first and then come back to Canada. Again, it all depends on how the song does up there.
You tell a story like Tokyo Rose. I got the picture from the stains on your clothes. Didn't they tell you about the shape I'm in? In this condition of carnosis.
I met Randy Backman, and we put together what was then Brave Belt and what ended up as being Backman Turner Overdrive. And up until probably... lately, they were probably the biggest Canadian act as a group that there was ever, that Canada's ever seen. We sold 10 million records with that group, and in 1976, they agreed, like all groups do, to disagree, and there was a fairly unamicable divorce. BTO is back, of course, together again, now opening for Van Halen, and best of luck to them, but I think, you know, the time has passed them by, but of course, the Monkees got back together, too. After BTO, there was the Prism era, where we had great success in Canada, sold about 300,000 records in Canada, but the group just didn't seem to catch down the States for whatever reasons, and that was the end of Prism. We went through groups like Powder Blues and Red Rider, up until a brash 17-year-old walked in my office about 7 years ago, and actually about 8 years ago now, and said that he was going to be the next big thing in Canadian music. Time has proved him correct. Bryan Adams probably is the biggest single star to ever come out of this country, and he's probably one of the top three or four acts in the world now. I would say he's probably only superseded at this point by Springsteen. I think 1987 with his next album will be the year of Bryan Adams, and we're very excited about it. Of course, between all of this, we also had Loverboy, which probably knocked off all the records that BTO had set. And Loverboy is probably the biggest act now that Canada's ever exported around the world. They just finished touring about a week ago in early September, and they're probably, in the States, they're probably the fifth biggest draw this year of any kind of entertainment, probably only beaten by one act, and that was ZZ Top. So Loverboy, Canada can be real proud of them. They're one of their best rock and roll exports, and there's many more good years to come for Loverboy, and we're looking forward to them.
So long, Pete Mitchell.
Not only number one in Canada, but everywhere in the world.
My trusted friend. We've known each other since we were 9 or 10. Together we've climbed hills and trees. Learned of love and ABC. Skinned our hearts and skinned our knees. Goodbye, my friend, it's hard to die. When all the birds are singing in. Now that the spring is in the air, pretty girls are everywhere. Think of me and I'll be there. We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons in the sun. But the hills that we climbed were just seasons out of time.
Now go ahead and tell me, you don't have a copy of that record. I think everybody does. Eastern Canada has given us a lot of chart busters. You got your groups like Rush, Triumph, April Wine, Glass Tiger. You want to go back? How about Crowbar, Foot in Cold Water, or Max Webster?
I remember seeing Max Webster in Winnipeg, and seeing the audience being it was really strange, a Cougar work boot type of export A.
Yeah.
Or,
you know. And I drove in the pickup truck there with them. Yeah, right.
Has that changed at all? Has there become
a little bit. You know, it depends from city to city. You know, Toronto, there's still a lot of people like that that come out. You know, yeah, the Moose Antlers and
right.
The Iron Lungs and the Dorsal Fins. Yeah, that's the.
You've produced Shaken Like a Human Being. First time solo. Yeah, sure. First time solo producing.
Yeah.
Why did you choose this route and not the co-producing thing again?
Because everyone else kept getting it wrong.
I know how to do it.
That's right. Move over. You don't know what you're talking about. Go for a coffee.
Long one. Couple of weeks.
I'll get these bed tracks done. Kind of half and half that and half I went, give me a couple weeks and I'll think about this, who I'd like to produce it. And I just kept putting it off and putting it off till it was time to do the album. And it was like, well, you better do it. And I said, yeah, I guess I better. So nobody else around.
Did you find any difference aside from the...
Yeah, a lot of times it was really neat. It was neat not having a producer there or just me being in control and the band, you know. Other times it was just a bit of a drain, you know. They'd be sleeping peacefully at night and I'd be up writing notes to myself about arrangements or something and trying to do stuff like that, you know. Mm-hmm. Just, I could have used a little more sleep is what I'm saying, you know, but when you're the producer, you can't leave the control room. You know?
Now I find it... At least me, anyway, find a sort of a more accessible album from Kim Mitchell than even Akimbo Ologo.
Uh-huh.
Was that an intention to make it a little more
My
accessible?
My intentions are only to hope that I make a better album each time and keep improving my songwriting. And I said that earlier, and mm-hmm. That's sort of my only intent, you know. And to experiment somewhat, you take a song, and when it's written, and you bring it to the band and you're going to record it, you take it to its natural conclusion. That's all you sort of do. And if that means it's a more accessible song or a country and western flavored type song, fine. Let her go, you know. As they've been saying to me across Canada, they yell out car windows, they roll down, like, hey, Kim, give her, eh? Give her tonight. I was like, that's all you do. You write a song and you give her.
All right, David Foster Trivia winners, you've won cassettes of David's solo album. And here is Fuzz with the question and the answer.
The question was, how many Grammys was I nominated for, have I been nominated for, and how many Grammys have I won? And the answer is, I've been nominated 20 times, and I've only won 4. No one will ever.
Do you remember the first 45 you ever bought? I do. Mine was The Band. It was up on Cripple Creek. You write us and let us know what you'd like to see in future shows, and please don't forget our fourth year. It's a birthday special, 2 parts, beginning next week. Interviews and highlights of the past 3 good rockin' years. Oh yeah, late start, 12:30 instead of 11:30, but check your local listings. Hey, we've come from A to Z on this show. We started with A for Adams and Anka, and we'll finish with Z for Zappacosta, who goes from A to Z because he's Alfie Zappacosta. And hey, have you heard the news? There's been good rockin' tonight. We'll see you next week.